the reason I want each of us to take the rainbow envelope, not to raise money, though I will not turn it back if you by chance do it. We need to have the capacity to meet rather quickly and on a more frequent basis. This stuff is moving so fast, and we're meeting so infrequently. We've lost the authority we once had even to convene the press to hear what we have to say. A sense of humiliation tone, I know there'll be people in Selma who'll be marching across the bridge who should be marching in Shelby. That's what they stand for. I don't want people marching in Selma who support Shelby. They are doing stuff to us. And we would be somewhere close to stupid to have people who are marching with us who are against us. If you're for Shelby, then say you. Because the dividing line, at the end of the day, I heard Tanya said most stuff I can comprehend. You're not from the country, so South Carolina got a lot of urban, rural problems from the South. I don't understand a lot of this stuff. What I do understand is we all got the right to vote, we ain't. And there was three things that kind of happened, Tanya and Barbara. In 65, we had the activists, the Congress, and the president. The president coming to Alabama must address Shelby. Because if Shelby had been in operation, he wouldn't have been president. Many of us would not be whatever we are in the scheme of things. It's a big deal. And my fear is that there are those who are hyped to come from the Congress. I went to Selma shout, who are against what we stand for. And there must be some line of demarcation established in that situation. And I really want the representative from Alabama to give us a little taste of what does it mean when you guys are stacked and packed. Come up here, please. Come and stacked and packed in districts and put in the back of the legislative bus in your own legislature. Give her a big hand, please, up here from Birmingham, Alabama.
Let me first thank Reverend Jackson for giving me the opportunity to speak with you all today. Sometimes in Alabama, way down south, we feel forgotten. And some of us still refer to ourselves as the Confederate States because of the things that are going on in the state of Alabama and in the Deep South. I was elected in 2002. I'm serving my fourth term in the Alabama House of Representatives. First elected at 28, very excited about the opportunity to serve my constituents, still excited about the opportunity to serve my constituents. But you know, when you're young, you feel like you can go in and you can change the world. That's the reason why I ran. I wanted to be able to do some great things. But since I've been serving, I've been, I have been exposed to the reality of political office and the reality of politics. And after the Democrats actually lost control, believe it or not, until 2010, in the state of Alabama, both the House of Representatives and the Senate on the state level were Democratic controlled. So there was a changeover. So when I was first elected in 02, I was one of 66 Democrats. Now I'm one of 33 Democrats in the House. When I was elected first in 2002, there were 21 senators in the state house, and now there are 9 Democratic senators in the state house. So Reverend Jackson asked me to talk a little bit about the impact of packing and stacking, or stacking and packing, and how that the numbers actually ended up changing because of redistricting. So again, in 2010, after the Republicans took a supermajority, they were charged then with the task of redrawing the lines after the 2010 census, of course. The numbers changed because African Americans were packed into those traditionally black districts, one like mine, that was gerrymandered and drawn for a black Democrat to win. So we were packed, and therefore we lost the influence in some of the majority white districts. So for example, in my district, prior to 2002, it was about 62% African American, went down to about 60% African American, still was able to win re-election in 2006. So then after the redistricting, I went from 60%, because remember, we lost population, then to almost 70%. So I was packed with some additional African Americans, because I did. Most all black districts or African American districts lost population. We had some discussions about it as a legislative black caucus with both the House and the Senate. We talked about wanting to be able to diversify our districts. We want to be able to represent all people. Some of us had been successful in being elected in districts that were not majority African American. So we want people to know that we can lead all people, not just African Americans in the state of Alabama. So again, my district went from 60% African American to 69 point, almost 70% African American. I have a colleague next door to me. Hi, Mr. Harris. How are you? I saw one of my colleagues from Alabama. His district went from 62% African American to 72% African American. So again, we lost that influence. You know, studies show that if you have at least 25% of minorities, and not just black folks, but minorities, period, you have an opportunity to influence the outcome of that election. You can influence who is actually elected. You can influence the political party that's elected. But you also can influence the issues that that elected official takes up. Even if someone who is not of your same hue or someone who is not in your same political affiliation wins that district, you have that influence because they have to recognize that I need to represent all people. But now I have colleagues in the Alabama legislature that serve districts that are 98% white. That does not look like Alabama at all. African Americans are 27% of the population. We should at least all be representing what Alabama looks like. So there was a strategic effort to pack and stack in the state of Alabama. It was done strategically. The Legislative Black Caucus just recently filed a brief. UW Clemens, who is one of our former federal judges, was one of the attorneys that filed this brief. And they took depositions, and they found out specifically that is what happened, that these districts were packed on purpose. We also lost. We had a member in the county that I'm from, just to give you the politics, Jefferson County, Alabama. We are traditionally a Democratic county. And the way our delegation works, we don't have home rule in the state of Alabama, so we take up a whole lot of local issues, take up a lot of time in the legislature taking up local issues. But we've been able to balance the outcome. Even when the Republicans were in the minority, they were able to balance some of the outcome because our legislative district on the House side was equal, 9 Democrats, 9 Republicans. It forced us to work together. We worked really well. But after redistricting, Demetrius Newton was our pro tem, African-American Democrat prior to the changeover. His district was completely drawn out of our county. Although we had significantly grown, we'd lost population as a county, but we had grown in African-American population. So we were trying to figure out why we lost an African-American seat, and it went up north to the great city of Huntsville. So as a result of that, we've gone now from 9 Democrats and 9 Republicans in the House to 10 Republicans and 8 Democrats representing a county that is majority Democrat. And it's unfortunate. We've already seen some of the changes that are on afoot. So I tell my kids, I have 2 teenagers, I tell them when I'm driving to Montgomery now, mommy's getting ready to fight. That's about it right now. That is our role now is to, we do lead, of course, we are developing legislation, but my goal right now is to make sure that the bad stuff does not come home. So it has been detrimental, the packing and stacking for the representation and whatever party affiliation. I don't know everybody's party affiliation, nor do I actually really care. But it is unfair when African Americans do not have the opportunity to influence, or any people do not have the opportunity to influence the outcomes in elections. So, again, it's been detrimental. Just a couple of other demographics I want to give you. Of those 33 Democrats that are left in the House of Representatives in the state of Alabama, only 6 of them are white. The same 27 African-American districts remain, but we're talking about, just a few whites that are left. In the Senate, 9, did my numbers add up? 9 Democrats left in the Senate in the state of Alabama, only 1 Caucasian left as a Democrat in the Senate in the state of Alabama. And he's representing a majority black district. So it's unfortunate that now the parties are down racial lines primarily. And again, that doesn't reflect who the state of Alabama is, and it does not reflect who this country is. So again, thank you for the opportunity to come and talk a little bit about what's going on in the state of Alabama. We look forward to working nationally. We look forward to the support nationally. We had thought that we were going to have, I missed some of your presentation, but we were looking for our five cases in the state of Alabama. The city that I live in, Pleasant Grove, which is one of those suburbs that a lot of people don't know about in the state of Alabama, that was one of the cities we were using. Well, we just got an African American appointed to the city council, although the city is 43% African American. We had never had a black elected official. We had no blacks that worked in City Hall, any appointed position. But now when we started meeting and discussing this, and we had the NAACP Legal Defense Fund come work with us, now we have an appointed African American. So I'd love to continue to have conversations with you all and see how we can help and not only support the state of Alabama, but these United States of America. Thank you.
Well, don't leave. Tanya, come here, please. I want Tanya to address what we've just heard, because this is right down where the goats can get it. One manifestation of it, South Carolina State is scheduled to be closed in June because the black officials elected have no juice because they're in the back of the bus of the legislature. Grambling State is scheduled to be closed because we have no power to protect ourselves. Alabama State and A&M are in trouble because and when we lose those places, they're going to say, well, we elected blacks, nothing happened. There's no sense of the impact of this shift. Now, what can be done, Tanya? What did your bill say to her?
I'm sorry.
We were talking.
I'm sorry.
Oh, Barbara, she can't stop. No, I'm simply saying, what does the fix say to her?
Closing the black schools, HBCUs.
Well, the fix isn't going to fix that, unfortunately. I mean, what you're talking about is redistricting. I mean, in some contexts, it could, we could, you know, I'm trying to think of, you know,
But to add to it, most of those schools, including Alabama State and A&M, they're wrapped into our state budgets.
Right. Uh-huh.
So if we lose the influence to be able to influence or to make sure that they are adequately funded.
Yeah.
Is a huge issue.
South Carolina State's about to be closed over $6 million. When they send $100 million back to Washington because they reject federal funds. I mean, that's the kind of impotence black elected officials now begin to have across the South.
So, yeah, I mean, I think what we're talking about, you were just discussing the redistricting challenges and all what has happened, you know, in the past number of years. A lot of, we spoke about the voter ID stuff, and all that stuff came to fruition because of 2010. People didn't get out and vote. Redistricting occurred. Everything kind of went to hell in a handbasket. The next cycle is 2020, and we're in process now. We're trying to get, you know, things on board and to, you know, make sure that people start paying attention to what's going to happen during the census. We still have Section 2 within the Voting Rights Act, and so you can still, you know, what is primarily utilized to deal with a lot of the redistricting issues. And so that is still in effect, but it's a high bar that we have to get to. And I would welcome Marcia to say something to this, but I mean, I suspect that what needs to happen is not only continued monitoring and making sure that we're making people aware about what's gonna be happening in that coming census and connecting the dots, but with regard to this Voting Rights Amendment Act, if there is an intentional violation that is still found, I mean, that can still come in. You know, Alabama, within this current compromise bill, could come within the trigger still. Okay, so you are not permanently excluded. It just happens to be right now, the way that the trigger is constructed, that Alabama doesn't fit into because I think you're like one or two away. As a result of the fact that Section 5 worked so well in Alabama. But to the extent that there are some additional violations that are found, it can still come under the trigger. And so then you would still have oversight, which then could stop immediately some of the problems that are occurring with regard to maybe potential violations that might occur, whether it be either, you know, through changing from at-large to, you know, single-member, stuff like that.
We've been able to stop that stuff.
We're just saying drives into the poverty question. Is that those who have the power to get in their districts industrial bases, tax bases, education, and jobs. So when they're over in the margins of the legislature, they really don't matter. Well, they're absent, they don't matter anymore. And any fix that leaves Alabama in the lurch, any fix that works for the people at the base.
I'm listening to Reverend Jackson, and you know that's kind of hard to take, but it is the truth.
Yeah.
Literally, the they don't need us to even show up to be able to conduct business whatsoever. It still moves forward.
Can I just add something about what we've lost? Interestingly, the preclearance remedy that we used to have covered any voting change, and that goes from redistricting, where there was actually an action pending in Texas when we lost it, and to little things like changes in polling places.
Right.
So that, you know, African-American turnout can change when a polling place goes from, you know, a sort of central convenient place to someplace out nowhere, not on a public transportation route. I mean, this happens. And so the issue of budgets and, you know, the trickle-down effect of redistricting, which obviously can change your member of Congress or the district from which your member of Congress comes, but also state legislative districts. So, you know, these things have tremendous impacts, and they can be sued about in a context of preclearance so that they would not go into effect until they were blessed by either the Department of Justice or the court. And now that we don't have that.
Right. And just to add to that, prior to, if there were going to be changes in polling places, because our county board of registrars, you know, knew that it had to be, they would call us. They would call us and say, hey, where do you suggest the polling place be moved? You know the district better than we are, you know, and we would be able to make those suggestions, whether it was a church or a school in the area. We no longer get those phone calls anymore.
Fort Valley State has 3,000 students on the campus. And people every day, they remove the voting rolls, booth from the campus, for example. And the reason I'm trying to surface this up, not antagonistic, is because this is family.
Right.
Just in real time, the Alabama Black Caucus is very disturbed about the massive celebration on their backs next week.
That's right.
Ignoring their pain. You get my point?
No. I get it.
And they're going to be a big party. And the host of the party don't feel good about the party.
Yeah, so, and let me just, before, and I know there's a lot of questions out there, but I want to say this. I don't disagree. And I think many of us are concerned. There are discussions underway, and this is why I want to continue this discussion. I actually ran into Representative Sewell, and I told her I wanted to speak with her probably, I'm going to speak with her this week. There are discussions underway about what it is that we can do to potentially, you know, make, what would another bill look like?
Right.
You know, just, to, you know, if something was out there, you know, and we can't deny that we need, obviously, we can't ignore, we've got a bipartisan bill out there, and we would still want to keep moving the ball forward because we've got to move something. But obviously, we want to continue to have those conversations. So, there are conversations that I would really hope that we can make sure that you are a part of.
Thank you.
And, you know, we've been meeting regularly, and I know that there's another conversation that will be taking place next week in Atlanta that's bringing together a lot of those, particularly, you know, it's beyond about, we don't need to talk amongst ourselves. We need to get out there beyond D.C. So that's taking place next week. And with regard to what's happening in Selma, let me just say this, that we are in the process of also putting together what we call a voting rights manifesto to kind of at least pull together what are our main principles that we want to see in a Voting Rights Act.
Right.
That's being written this week because it has to be finished and ready to go by Selma. So, and that's a conversation I'd love to have with you. We're trying to figure out what that's going to look like, but it's a set of principles.
Okay.
And that can be used as kind of that backdrop to say this is what we need to move forward.
I think there are three people. One, two, three. Will there be room in this for minority report, so to speak, on what's being proposed?
What? Say it again.
I'm hoping we're
will
on the same
page. Will there be a minority
page?
Report? I disagree profoundly with this legislation. I disagree, but in the context of our family meeting, because I do not see any help for people I know who need help in it, and I see privatized jails and prison labor going up, black schools being closed, and this does not correspond to the pain. That's just a point of view, not enough for me to walk away from the family, you know. I'm telling you there's another dimension, and I must say I left Shelby sick and fired up because Shelby is a rich, suburban, white, Republican county.
Largest growing county in our state.
And then that is Dallas, 40% black unemployment, which Selma comes from. And the richest took on the poorest and defeated them.
That's right.
There and in Washington. And somehow our fight must correspond to the trigger.
Right.
One, two, Frank. Yes, ma'am.
So the other thing I wanted to put on the table, and I think the other thing that I just wanted to put on the table and get representatives' thoughts on is that the Supreme Court is looking at the Alabama redistricting. And so there's soon going to be a decision on that. And we need to be prepared for that decision because we have a Supreme Court that hasn't shown itself very friendly to voting rights, and also there are lots of discussions happening now around redistricting reform and what that can look like in 2020, and are those proposals being considered in Alabama as well?
I will tell you that we are definitely being proactive in the event that the ruling comes down in our favor. We already have district lines that have been redrawn that do set up those influence districts. Actually, we presented two proposals during the redistricting process. So we're being, at least in Alabama, we're being proactive, trying to prepare ourselves in the event that we have the opportunity to have a second go at it. But in addition, we're meeting as a caucus. This is we have kind of gotten complacent. I'll just be honest with you. And Reverend Jackson came and met with some of us, and I love you fired us back up. And one thing that I love that he said to us was, you know, as black elected officials, all of these things are going on around the country as it relates to voter IDs and all kinds of things to disenfranchise the vote. But worse than their scheming is your silence. Worse than their scheming is your silence. So we've gotten re-energized. I love it.
That's a tweet. Say it again.
Yeah, worse than their scheming, yes, is your silence. So we have started meeting again. You know, we were bruised and battered. We were really bruised and battered. We weren't beaten, but we were bruised and battered. So we weren't meeting like we should in the interim prior to the session starting. And we've been meeting every week. I actually have a meeting with the Legislative Black Caucus this Thursday coming up. That's been unprecedented for us for a while now. So we're getting together. We're talking about what the options are for us and making sure that we're cohesive. I want to backtrack to Selma, if you all will just because I have the microphone, I have to use this opportunity. I co-chaired President Barack Obama's campaign in the state of Alabama in 2008. So I just want to give you that history. I've been a big supporter of the president for many years now. I was one of the people on the list from the state of Alabama. Anything going on in the White House, I received that phone call to represent. I was one of his official surrogates for the campaign in the state of Alabama. So I've taken a position, though, on the Selma Bloody Sunday March that I really wish that the president would honor the tradition of having that march on the Sunday. Of course, the date is March the 7th, and we are glad that President Barack Obama and others are coming to the state of Alabama. But Selma is not trendy. Selma is not Hollywood. Selma is real. And when everybody leaves, there's still going to be high unemployment rates in Selma, and along with the state of Alabama. And we want people to recognize, especially the president of these United States of America, that I have supported wholeheartedly for all of these years, that we need help, and we want to make sure that others don't co-opt an event that has been done the same way for the past 40 years, that it doesn't co-opt the local elected officials, that it doesn't co-opt the foot soldiers who were on Edmund Pettus Bridge, who were beaten and bruised 50 years ago. So I'm hoping that people will come to the state of Alabama. We do need your tax dollars. We need it. Come for the entire week. But please don't forget that on Sunday, March the 8th, the actual march will be happening. The reenactment will be happening on March the 8th. And I just echoed when I came in when you were talking about all of the Republicans that pretty much are going to, not your words, my words, going to be singing Kumbaya in Selma and then ultimately Montgomery. Again, it's not trendy. We need help. We need to be able to make sure that every voter in the state of Alabama is enfranchised, not disenfranchised. If they want to get on board with that, I'm with them, but I'm not for the show, the pomp and circumstance. I'm for some real action.
Yes, ma'am.
So I just wanted to piggyback on what Tanya had said in response to the question around what can the Voting Rights Amendment Act do for Alabama. And I think that we know, as Tanya had said, it's not perfect. It is clearly a compromise bill. You know, the idea being it's better than where we are, which is nothing. Mm-hmm. And I think for Alabama, one of the things that Tanya had mentioned was expanding the bail-in provision, I think, is one key way that could be beneficial to Alabama. Yes, it still requires litigation to be brought. I'm sure it won't be difficult to find some type of litigation to bring around voting rights in Alabama. And, you know, when you factor in the egregious history of the state, then that is something that, because you just need a Section 2 finding under the bill, you would potentially be able to bring Alabama in back into preclearance. And on top of that, I think that if we had this bill in place and we had the rolling trigger in place, we can get strategic, right? If you are but one or two violations away, then maybe that's where the resources get spent in making sure that we can get those extra violation or two to be able to bring this in, because it is a rolling trigger, because it's something that's going to be looked at annually. I think that while it's not perfect, it's not completely unattainable. And I think that, as Tanya said, you know, we will, of course, also look at other ways to make things better. But I just want to be clear that I think the baseline is something that we can work with, even if it's not exactly where we want to be.
I have a question. Oh, go ahead. Well, my question was back on, because, again, I came in the midst of your presentation, and I mentioned that the city that I live in, 43% African-American, now there is an appointed city council person. Does that city now, or can we not use that city anymore? Because we still don't have an elected elected official in the city. They still have at-large elections. We've been able to prove that when African-Americans run, they do not get elected at-large.
See why not? I mean, it doesn't. I don't believe. I think that if you bring a case and mm-hmm. if they're found to have a voting rights violation, it could still be counted. You just have to bring the case.
Right. I mean, we have this problem right now in the, if I'm right, in the Baton Rouge case that we brought, dealing with judges, where, you know, some of the judges, you know, because they weren't. They had the districts drawn so that you could not really elect an African-American judge in some of the districts. But there had been one appointed, but we, you know, obviously that does not somehow dilute your case or hurt your case if there's an appointment. It's still the question is what happens during elections and the impact.
Thank you for that.
Uh-huh. Yeah. One of the things I wanted to point out, Barbara mentioned that they're pretty much on top of changes at the state level and so forth. But if I recall my facts correctly, 89% of the pre-clearance cases were local, mm-hmm. not at the state level. So it's very concerning that we seem to be aware, you know, at the top level, but maybe most of the stuff is going on at the local level.
Yeah, that's why I mentioned polling place changes, because right. at that level, We'll never hear about it in Washington right. unless somebody calls and complains. But it used to be that you'd have to inform the Department of Justice that that's what you were planning to do.
And that's why the notice provisions in the Voting Rights Amendment Act are extremely important, which I don't think get highlighted enough, because that is a requirement that any type of voting change like that actually be reported in a way that the entire public has notice.
Mr. Moore?
My question was about consent decrees. And would the language that we have now require that the civil rights litigation community stop consent decrees so that we don't have situations where this goes on forever? People go up to the gate and then basically settle out of court so that they don't get triggered in?
I'm not going to answer that affirmatively one way or another. What I am going to say is that a strategy would have to be devised to determine what's going to be in the best interest for everyone to move the ball forward to make certain that states are covered. So you're right, consent decrees aren't covered right now within the trigger, but a determination will have to be made, obviously, as to what strategies we're going to employ. Just like what Terry was saying, we have to determine where we're going to put our resources to gauge a fight. A battle, and I think that decision has to be made on a case-by-case basis.
And I should say, Greg, that I'm one of the people who absolutely disagree with the exclusion of consent decrees as part of the trigger. I really think that the Justice Department has their own position there, and that they ought to be advocating for the inclusion of consent decrees as part of any trigger analysis. I also think that we probably haven't thought enough about other possibilities of how consent decrees could be used by courts as a methodology of considering, you know, different liability of states. So I think that we should think some more, but that's been, you know, my position for a long time, is that the exclusion of consent decrees is a mistake in the trigger.
Barbara, one of my concerns here is that we start from what we need and back up to what we think we can get. If we start what we think we can get, we'll end up with less than we thought we could have got. How can I put this?
Right.
When I was in Selma, the
no,
morning.
No, we know the that's morning, the worst.
Well, the reason I don't mean no harm, I'm just trying to raise it. When I went over to Mrs. Boynton's house in 1965, and Dr. King was there, and we had found out a trace on who killed James Reeb. Mm-hmm. Dr. King was on the phone with Robert Kennedy, who, so I know you need the right to vote, but two things. One, don't march. It'll create more disturbance, and we can protect. Number two, that if we can just get to a sixth grade literacy level, that they negotiate from 12th grade, that's the answer to know one person will do it. If they're not literate, then have another education. I mean, he stayed on the course of what we needed, one person, one vote. They want to have a 12th grade literacy level, then sixth grade literacy level. And so there must be a way. The students who are marching, for example, who we applaud, they must be driven with some information they're marching on what matters. I asked a group of kids down, we were down in Ferguson. I said, now in light of what has happened, we should march, and we should vote with a passion. And one of them said, I'm tired of voting, because he had never voted before in the first place, but he was tired. And I said, well, if you were in the jury when the killer, Michael Brown, came out, would you vote against him? I'd bust him. I wouldn't punk out. I said, okay. You do know you have to be a registered voter to serve on the jury. He said, oh. He just did not know. He had run past political power in his fervor. He'd run past it. Yeah. And so it seems somehow we've got to connect that wing with what we need. And there's a compromise of sorts by those who must do the intricacies. But somebody got to argue, if you got the right to have a gun in the amendment, you ought to have a right to vote. We got to come on down with it and create a kind of creative tension, not the kind of tension makes us throw our gauntlet down and run and leave each other, because we got the support. Y'all get my spirit here? Yeah. Because sometimes, if I don't have my way, I'm leaving. No, we can lose our point without losing our way. Right. So we can lose our point without losing our way. There's so many dimensions to the reason why I want to hurry here, because she brings a different dimension of a reality-based situation, because she is in that situation. Leslie run up and down the road, these black colleges, for example, we're going in next week, we're gonna meet with Honda, Hyundai, and Mercedes-Benz, I think it is. Huh?
Which state?
In Alabama. And the point is, here's what's happening, Barbara. Once you get that kind of dominant power, you get all them built in your districts. And you get University of Alabama and Auburn in your district. Right. And as they get more resources, Alabama State and Alabama A&M get less resources. It just keeps on flowing. And because what happened for a while, I went to A&T. When the blacks first came with these influence districts, we start, for example, Ali got back in the ring because Senator Johnson from Georgia, Barbara, Senator Leroy Johnson, was the one senator was able to get Ali back in the ring. He had that much influence operating between. Black colleges start getting buildings we had never dreamed of having before. Because once we start trading off deals for the NCC, got a law school, be big and anything. Now we're losing the capacity to save what we got.
That's right.
On that side. Not to mention that they're coming south now, the dealerships, high tech, biotech. We're locked. We have no legislative power. Any arrangement that does not give us our power back is somewhat short of what we really need. So, I mean, let's think it through. I don't have the complete answer. Let's think through how deep this water is, guys.
Well, see, this is where I think that we can't, we can talk about, the legislative fixes, and we have, as we've talked about what could be done, but I think that we have to conceptually rethink how we're looking at voting rights, mm-hmm. okay. and what the fundamental struggle is about. Because it's really not about, Dems, Repubs. That's representative right. of a different struggle. Mm-hmm. I think the fundamental struggle in the United States right now is how do we eliminate the artificial power maintenance mm-hmm. that exists in favor of whites in the U.S. And that's really what the problem is.
Tyranny
is that
majority. No,
it's not even the majority. I mean, it's the fear is that as they become, less dominant, mm-hmm. that you need more artificial structures to maintain power. And that's what voter suppression is. It's fundamentally a methodology of maintaining an unequal, undemocratic power maintenance. And if I could finish, because what I see that's problematic is that if you look at the actual population stats and demographic stats, what we have as power centers in our country don't match any of it. And there's a total, imbalance in racial, representation. And we got all these strictures out there that says that, that's not a proper, standard to look at political participation on. So I think that the real problem is, and the reason why is that we do not have a system of, until we build a system of talking to white voters in a way that they can break down their fear of a true democracy, of a true integrative, inclusive democracy, where they don't believe that they, quote, are losers in such a process, that we're going to keep seeing all this nonsense. Because mm-hmm. I think that, because the reality is that you talked about Alabama, but I'm thinking about Maryland, where I live,
right.
where you didn't even have a redistricting problem. Mm-mm. But still, you saw a fundamental shift,
right.
In the voting last time, where you had the same dynamics that you're describing. So I don't think it's the political. I think the political structure absolutely has a lot to do with what's going on. But I also think it's this mindset that we have not figured out a way to talk with, and how to deal with it. And that if we don't figure out a way to fundamentally change the views of white Americans about a inclusive, multicultural, multiracial democracy, then we can't get there. I just think that that's what's wrong.
Tony, and then...
especially for those people that say that they support the U.S. Constitution. And
They don't support that.
Reverend, I wanted to just echo your thoughts about where do you begin to negotiate? I remember the 82, and someone from Washington came down to the South and told us how we were going to do that. And they brought the message from the Beltway. This is how y'all, no. We are here living with the beast. We will not have you telling us inside the Beltway how we going to negotiate for our rights here in the South when we live with this beast every day. So we went back, and our strategy was, let us go back to what we need, what you left on the table in the House before you got to the Senate, and let's go back and reclaim that which, as a part of the negotiations, that which was left on that table. So I do think that there is a need for some additional dialogue on what is it that we are fighting for, and how does this negotiation take place that gets us to where we are now. Because, I mean, the argument keeps out of being, well, we're getting a little bit more than we had, and we had nothing. So the question is, what is the little bit more that we're getting, and is that so close to nothing that it's a question of how much we're actually getting?
Leslie? Can I acknowledge that Mr. Harris used to serve in the Alabama House of Representatives and has gone on to do bigger and better things now? And I do appreciate his leadership through the years and his support.
Her district was next to mine.
A resident militant. Okay.
Is this on?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I think my question may have been answered, but I was trying to see if we might figure out how to add other triggers in the bill. Yeah. So currently,
is that what
you're talking about? Uh-huh.
So I was talking about the consent decree issue.
As another trigger.
I think you either include it in the trigger or you find out another way of counting it. And I think that it's a mistake to pretend that those consent decrees are not out there.
What is you all's position, though, on not including the consent decree?
So let me just clarify. No. it's I want to clarify, I think that the civil rights community, and I believe that I can say this speaking for all of us, would like for the consent decrees to be included within the trigger. That wasn't something that we had a choice in. This bill was introduced in the House. It was not our bill. It was a bill that was introduced in the House by the members of Congress. If we would have had our druthers, there would have been differences, including all of us would love to have Alabama included. I mean, there is a number of things we would like to see being done. So that's why I'm saying that the conversation is not stopped. I think that that's why we're in continual conversation right now to figure out how we can move this ball forward and what a re-envisioned bill that we would love to see would look like.
Yeah. Can I add something about consent decrees?
I know, Carrie, you probably want to say something about the other trigger realities too.
Let me mention something else about consent decrees, and that sort of brings us back to the mundane level in a way. Project Vote works mainly on voter registration issues and sues a lot on voter registration issues, along with the Lawyers Committee and other colleagues. But one of the issues is the federal law called the NVRA, which is better known as Motor Voter, which has to do with violations that states conduct in registering people at, for example, public agencies and also driver's license, DMVs. Those often, if not usually, result in consent decrees because it's a numbers game. You say to a state, you've only registered 25 people in the last 6 months at the public welfare agency, they say, oops, caught us. I mean, it's pretty obvious when they're in violation of the law most of the time. When it's worth it for us to sue, it's because it's pretty obvious. And that results in a consent decree, but it basically, you can translate as the state knew it was wrong. So it is, in essence, a violation. It just was in everybody's interest to get it out of the court and get it agreed to, and, you know, an implementation process and a monitoring process to make things better. And I just wanted to add one thing, since we're all sort of putting in plugs for our own organizations. Project Vote has two recent publications that I think would be of interest to this audience for sure. One is about who has photographic IDs and who doesn't. And another is called Representational Bias in the Electorate, which obviously has to do with who votes and who doesn't. So these are on our website, projectvote.org, but I do think that there are reports that are germane to this discussion.
But, see, but right now, with the redrawing the lines, if blacks vote 95%, they'll have no more part in the 45%.
One more time.
If blacks vote 95% in them all black districts, they go to Montgomery and have no more power than 45%.
That's true.
That's exactly right.
Huh?
We're packed.
Yeah.
They've been drawn out of power, and that's just becoming typical. That's why Confederates are taking over Virginia around to Texas. We got to think through how to fight that. I want somebody to march me, Shelby. So as to begin to start this right now, we're on the discussion of a great rearview mirror.
Right.
There's a windshield out here, guys, and Selma is really, really gone. And Shelby is really, really getting stronger. And the less we fight it, the stronger Shelby is going to get. And I see some of our allies who once did march in Selma now don't want to deal with Shelby, because Shelby represents a defeat and a challenge. We won Selma. So it's good to talk about the tailwind. And this time, we will not look across the bridge and see blue shirts. We'll see some black robes coming back this way with far more power than the blue shirts had, right? And so it's like the 1896 moment. Here we come. So I don't want us to miss the gravity of this moment. Y'all get my spirit, friend? This moment, I think, I've heard Barbara make a case, and she helps me all the time. I don't think we realize the gravity of Shelby. Am I off on that?
I think
we have missed Shelby's gravity. Dr. Lady?
We've missed it in Alabama. We're trying to catch up. You're exactly right. Were you, because we never did really get a chance to finish your question.
When I was talking about additional triggers, I was certainly talking about the consent decree, but I was talking about broader triggers. So going back to what Reverend said about we should start off with what we want. If the unequal funding of public institutions in the states is an indicia of inequitable voting, then why would not they be a trigger? So if you have either a legal finding, an administrative finding, or a decree relative to redlining, relative to education equity, why would not they be triggers as well? Because one of the beauties about this Congress is that everybody is going to throw into whatever legislation is moving, whatever they want. Mm-hmm. So I certainly embrace your sense that we need to start out with what we want and then end up with what we can get. But the negotiations should not start with keeping it narrowly defined. Because if we look at what flows directly from the denial or abridgment of the right to vote, and we start looking at housing and human needs services, education, why would not patterns of violations in those areas or persistent history of inequitable funding in those areas be a trigger also?
Well,
you're absolutely right. It's not politically possible in most people's eyes. But if we don't start with what somebody says is impossible, we won't even get near to what we want.
The only thing about
you want to go. Go ahead, I was just going to say, I'm sorry. An important component of this that Tanya mentioned is this notion of getting folks to call in. I mean, one of the purposes here today is to bring public attention to this issue and getting average folks to call in and call their members, whether they be R's or D's, and say, this is important, this is a priority, right? And then that can help move the substance of the VRAA, right?
Because I know some Democrats in prominent high positions not fighting for Section 4 to be revived. They've already decided this can't be won, so they won't fight because it can't be won. Well, we got here by fighting.
That's right.
And the blood from what thought to be a lost fight in March 7th became a winner August 6th. This will not be a bloodless struggle. There must be some relationship between those who handle the inside intricacies of this stuff and another infantry that goes the other way, not goes, I mean, it goes a different way. Tony, I kind of got Alabama on the brain right now because there's so much Alabama stuff. Mm-hmm. And I see people coming to Alabama to celebrate in 2 weeks from now who are our enemies politically. I mean, they'll be coming showboating and knocking marches off the front line because they got to do their thing. And it's really insulting. The people in Alabama, the 50 state reps, they're being pushed to the back of their own party. And it's really emotional. Tony, you know what I'm talking about. Tanya?
Yeah, and I appreciate what Spencer just said. What we need to bring to light is that we are not even able to have a real conversation on Capitol Hill about this bill, because we have a chairman of the Judiciary Committee who has already stated that he doesn't believe that anything needs to be done about the Voting Rights Act. We didn't even have...
Right now. No, the reason that's because if that's his point, we need to know what the enemy's point is. I mean, that's the point. If the enemy said, we are happy with things, we ain't.
That's huge.
So I mean, that's a big, because that's the stake in the ground.
And that's why I wanted to bring it to light, that this is what we're fighting against. We weren't even able to have a hearing on the legislation last term, all right? And so we just reintroduced the Voting Rights Amendment Act. We need to have the conversation. So what you were talking about, Leslie, I think is instructive. I appreciate that conversation. It's, I think that it is gonna be a stretch to make that point and include that as a voting rights violation, because we're talking about racial discrimination in voting, which is a very high bar, and proving that nexus that you're talking about, you know, especially with this court. I don't, you know, but I'm not gonna make a judgment on that, but what I write at this point, but I will say that the conversation should be held on a level in which we at least are talking about all of these different variations. So I appreciate that, but in order to get to that conversation, we need people to actually call in and say, we need to have the conversation so that we can move the ball forward.
Tony, and then you, I'm sorry.
Saying, raising the issue that you think you may not win so that you can get to what you want to win.
Tony?
I just wanted to add the severity of this conversation. I mean, we cannot have a conversation any more important than this, because I've been getting beat upside the head for projecting that we won't get the House back until 2030-something. And we are then locked in now to who is going to be in control of the drawing in 2021. And he, she who is in the drawing in 2021 are the same folks who drew what we have now. So if who is in power now is going to redraw in 2021, what do you think we're going to get? That is what we have now. In the state legislatures, as my senator said, they solidified their control.
Yes.
And in most, they expanded the control of the respective House and Senates in these legislatures across where we are. We are now the most disenfranchised people in America because of what has been said here today. That ain't changing unless the redistricting piece, and we got no power. I'm scared to death that what we're gonna face in 2021 is a continuation of the is that takes us well into 2030. And then where are we then? Now, what can we do about it? It has been mentioned about voter registration. I think voter registration is maybe a key to what we have to try to use to force some change.
And we just gotta educate the voters.
And one of the things that we got to add to that is educating our communities on the meaning and value of participating in this thing called politics. Because there's a disconnect with all the black elected officials that we have in the South and across the nation. There's a disconnect between having them there and the value of having them there. And we need to educate our communities in ways that we stop doing.
Tony, I'm not sure that our leadership and districters will sit down this long to get some good information. Before we get to the community, the conduits to the community, those who drop little politics stuff, they'd be dropping little one-liners. They don't stop long enough to get some good information. And so they are at the, I'm with President, ain't with President, that this is so much deeper than the leadership conversations. You watch them on MSNBC, and the leadership conversation is light. It is not, you can't hear Tanya and Barbara on them shows. You cannot hear people on the, except for Al, hell, ain't nobody else with a platform. And they, the way they gerrymander us out of talking, because it ain't cute. I mean, except for politics, nation. Except for that, we ain't got. I'm telling you, it's somebody got to get pissed off. This thing is getting deep, dark, y'all. I'm telling this thing is getting real, real, and it's jails for profit and prison labor. It's automotive companies out of our district. It's biotech out of our district. It's closing black schools. I mean, this thing is going real, real tough, and we're almost about to get casual. But we're about to get at ease in Zion. I wish I'd preach for a minute here, right?
Yes. Reverend, y'all have to make, excuse me one second, elected officials accountable. When I first came in, it was a big deal to be a citizen legislator, to really be responsive to your constituents and, you know. But now, we know everything. We know absolutely everything. But somebody has to. Somebody has to make us accountable so we can sit down and get this information.
Well, you know, one of the things, as you call it, Greg, is we did do in Alabama, we used Dr. King's selective patients. We kind of focus on a place. Alabama is still the heart of this mess. If you can't solve, we got from Alabama, we're losing in Alabama. We won in Selma, we're losing in Shelby. We can't get so spread out into it, because what happened in Alabama has broad application. It's true everywhere, Tony, but unless we start someplace, and Alabama having to be that hot spot for whatever reason, since that's going to be the spot of the drama and the museums and all that stuff, we cannot miss that scene and have interpretations that are less than we had. We think we got more than we had because we got more black faces. We really have less in the last 2 years than we got in the first 48. Because a lot of those black faces won't be back there next election. They've been drawn out of power. Greg, and that's it. Yes, sir.
Reb, my point was back to what you were just saying earlier in the state senator. In 2006, when they passed the Voting Rights Act extension, I think they did it because they felt they had to do it, not because they wanted to do it. There's a lot of members on that House Judiciary and Senate Judiciary Committee that otherwise would have voted against us, and they felt back in 2006, when we had the lobby day on the Hill and all the energy, that they had to do it. The President Bush signed a bill because he had to do it. Right now, I don't think they feel like they have to do it, and I think our job is to make sure they feel that they have to do it. They have to do something they don't want to do. And as long as they feel that they can get away with saying there's no need for it, we have to up our game.
Tony, where's the president on this bill?
The president has stated that he supports, obviously, moving forward on a voting rights fix. Has there been an actual, and I'm looking at you, Terry, because I don't know whether or not he actually released official position on the bill. It is not to say he doesn't support, it's just that the bill has not progressed anywhere in committee. We haven't had a hearing on it. There has been no official reason for the administration to release a position on the bill. That being said, we have had multiple meetings with the administration indicating a support for a fix of the Voting Rights Act. So the question on the table is not whether or not the president supports something, it's just, you know, what are we going to have moving forward and getting the House to actually move forward with the bill?
Back to those Johnson King scuffles in the movie, we need presidential leadership, not acknowledgement. We need that leadership, and because he has the juice.
Let's also be clear. We know strategically that whatever the president says he supports or wants to move forward, the Republicans automatically reject. So I think we need to also be mindful of the strategy. We've actually, and let's, I'll say this, you know, from a coalition standpoint, we actually asked the administration to stay behind the scenes intentionally at certain points to kind of move the ball forward. There was a strategic reason for that because
I'd rather Democrats show up, fight, and lose and surrender without fighting. I get a sense people
don't
want to fight.
But that wasn't what I was saying. What I was saying is that from a strategic position to move the ball forward, we needed to make sure that we had an opportunity to have that discussion. And because of the animosity against the president by those in power right now in the House, it was not helpful for us to have the administration out there full-fledged supporting if we wanted to actually have a conversation. And that's and I think, but that's part of a strategy. It doesn't mean that we're not trying to move the ball. We just had to figure out how to get it moving forward.
Our constituency will not know what the foe is unless the fight is defined. Whether we lose fighting the right fight and win fighting the wrong fight. I don't think we can leave anybody at home on this fight. Because it will motivate us to fight for the next election. I mean, because we run the danger now of our own constituents concluding that those who they have done nothing. We've sent you online, then nothing happened. And they don't even know why ain't nothing happening. You get what I'm trying to say? They assume because nothing is happening, nobody's working. People are really, really working. But you're working in a can't win deal. Well, if you can't win, then that becomes a starting point for the big fight. We've always defined the foe, and then the fight took off. Because there are some people, there's some few influence, particularly as we move toward 2016. Somebody needs us in 2016. And if we allow the Shelby people to get some of our votes because they're smiling better, if we've not defined the pro and anti-Shelby, we cannot define the get out the vote thing. I mean, the people who are pro Shelby, they shouldn't be marching with us and around with us or nothing with us. We need to know who they are because they are not our political allies. And if we soft shoe them, they're going to run us out the room. Yes, sir. I'm sorry to cut you off. You, sir.
Me?
Yeah.
About beyond, if everyone turns out and we have 95% turnout, there's no change in power. And so like the conversation needs to shift further than a right to vote. We need a right to a meaningful vote.
There we go.
When 51% of the vote equals one representation in a Republican district and 95% of the vote equals one representation in a Democratic district, that's not fair. And that's votes aren't correlating to power. And so I think we need to talk about the fact that we have single winner districts, one person can only win in a district. I feel like that really is the starting point for
that's
a conversation.
That's the way well-educated majority of people think. You're thinking like a real majority, and I like that one. You got this one.
I like that.
Listen, as we prepare to go, this has been, put your hands together, this has been a good session. Barbara, yes, ma'am.
Yes, a couple things. You know, I think that, this whole Selma movie and everything has been, has been in some ways, good to, really get people thinking. Now, of course, I had the infamous discussion with the director about the fact that at the end of the movie, it tells nobody that the vote, that the VRA is under threat. and was told by the director that this was because they're artists. And that the artistry of wanting to make the movie not time dated is why they didn't do that. And I pointed out, well, then why do you have a song like Glory talking about Ferguson, in the same movie? And that there was an inconsistency. So I think that what we should be thinking about is this. Selma is what Selma shall be. What I'm thinking is, why wouldn't we be thinking about some forms of actions in the Congress around, like March 21st or a date that we pick, and that we just flood the House with people of color. Saying they're there, making very clear that they're there because they want a new Voting Rights Act.
Rainbow.
And people who support, because I'm going to tell you, the most incredible moment of 2008 when we were pushing for the reauthorization, I'm sorry, in 2006, when we were pushing for the reauthorization was when people just took over the halls of Congress. And you never seen so many legislators running up and down those halls out of fear. Oh, it was amazing. And they kept saying, what does all this mean? You know, all these people, you know, they got really concerned because they understood this was not going to be an issue they could get away with. So we're talking about, you know, Selma, it is just one moment in time. And what we got to be very clear about is it's our ongoing strategy that we need to be talking about. Because Selma's a blip in that ongoing strategy, right? So the question becomes, you know, how do we really sit down and figure out how to bring the heat? And if we make a political calculus, you know, if we make the political calculation that the heat's not going to work no matter what in this time, then what do you bring to set it up?
Let me finish.
Because, see, the thing I love about what our folks have done is that, you know, from Reconstruction until 1964, you know, blacks were pushing and, you know, Latinos were pushing every year for legislation that would, in fact, have the same import of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965, et cetera. People didn't just stop because the political reality was stacked. And what I think we got to be thinking about is we got to be thinking on multiple fronts of not only, you know, strategically how to bring the heat, we also need to be thinking about how to utilize all the different tranches of our of not just our political power, but our economic power and our other power to make this heard. So I think we have to really start looking at this in a broader fight. And I think that that's what's missing, is that we can't be caught up in a trick bag of Sensenbrenner, Selma movie, Selma March, and not thinking strategically long time about how we win it. Yes, absolutely. I believe in it. I think the most underutilized power that people of color have in this country is not using economic boycotts.
But how do you get younger people involved in that?
They love it. They love it. They love economic boycotts.
They love it, but it seems to be very unfocused. I'm with USA Today. My name is Michelle.
Yeah.
We've done some reporting and some work around what younger people feel about civil rights and where they're going.
It just is confusing.
Have lots of different organizations, things that bubble up from grassroots, but there is no one leader. They don't want one leader, and it's not very, very well focused. So how then can we work with them? How do people work with them in order to create that sort of pressure so that it doesn't become a flash mob?
We have to keep it simple. The simple fact is, we're going to Selma, which has been trumped by Shelby. Selma gave us something we didn't have, federal protection. And every scheme they came up with, moving boundaries, gerrymandering, annexation, at-large, rural prison, non-proportional, winner-take-all, we beat them because we had the federal troops in. They never gave up on the troops leaving. When they removed the troops since that time, now comes ID and 600,000 Texas votes taken away. Now comes stacking and packing. Now come the laws, the isolation of blacks within power within those districts. Now comes removing, denying 4 congressional seats for Latinos in Texas. I mean, it's almost before and after. And that is so simple, even they must understand. What is an influence district? We had to learn what is an influence district? Do they need 60-70-30? Do they need 55-45? A 50-50? I mean, and I'm not sure we've sat down and worked through the implications of that because, again, when we're down there, going back there the next week, every major new and economic construction is just going on left and right, but it's all in the majority district.
Well,
Because, I'm sorry.
Reverend, I want people to be very clear. You know, I mean, I find this critique of the young folks really disturbing. And let me tell you why. Keene enters Selma after, you know, of course, Snick and others had been there for years. The Montgomery boycott is 54, everybody. I mean, I'm sorry, the Montgomery boycott is 55. And it takes 10 years to get to Selma. I mean, I just want people to think about this. And we're critiquing these kids who have been out in the streets now for 7 months, a good 7 to 8 months, and talking about they don't have a massive program, they don't have all of this structure, they don't have, you know, infrastructure, they don't have, you know, massive long-range goals, all of this stuff. This is a movement that is young and it's maturing. It's going to take it some time to mature to a level where it needs to be. It's amazing what they've been able to do in these years. Part of that's because Dream Defenders had been out there since Trayvon, right? So they at least had that three-year benefit. But remember that most of the youth leadership that developed under the Trayvon movement disappeared and dissipated because we did not create a structure for sustaining it. And one of the issues I have is that I think it's unrealistic to be telling them that, you know, Black Lives Matter, hands up the rest of them, that they are immature. Yes, it's a young movement. I mean, it's 8 months old. What do you expect?
But you know what?
So hold on. Let me finish, please. Right. Because it really disturbs me, because I deal with these, you know, young kids, and I see what they're under, the pressure they're under, just even having a safe place to sleep at night, the police brutality and, you know, and harassment of them, the economic pitfalls that they're in. You know, I just think we need to really step back a second and say a couple of things. What are we giving them in the sense of support and guidance and wisdom and whatever they'll take from us? What are we doing to help to, you know, strategize with them to get them there? And also, looking at some of the stuff that Black Lives Matters has done, I think part of the problem is that there hasn't been an elevation where people understand what they actually are demanding. Because they got some great stuff out there. They got some solid stuff that we need to be looking at and analyzing better and promoting and latching on to. So I think that the critique is unfair. I don't like it. And I repudiate it at every single level, because I think that it is, it's not where we need to be. What we need to be saying to them is not that, quote, you don't have it together. We need to be, and that you're wrong because you want a multi-shared leadership structure. There's nothing wrong with that. The ANC used it. All kinds of movements have used it. I think that what's wrong is that we don't conceptualize well what is possible in this day and its era with the technology we have, and that we need to be able to look at this and say, okay, it's different. What is effective about it? What's not effective about it? And how can it be better? And how can we help make it better?
Barbara, yes, ma'am.
I almost forgot my point, but I do. I, in my everyday job, I'm a professor at an HBCU.
Uh-oh,
I'm at Miles College. So I'm with young people all the time. And again, I really could echo a lot of what you said as it relates to, but what I've given them is a place. And a voice. I am sponsoring a piece of legislation in the state of Alabama to set up the special prosecutor in police-involved shootings. So instead of just the public displays, they now have a piece of legislation to rally around.
Yes, that's what they
want. And they've gotten me excited because now I have the additional support that I hadn't had before. In Alabama, we don't, because I'm not in the majority anymore, I don't have staff support. So my young people now, who are actively involved in this issue, have become my staff support
when it comes to social media and getting things out there. We've got to give young people a role. We can't tell them, wait your turn. Now, I had that even happen to me as a legislator at 28. Wait a minute, it's not time yet. Wait 2 years, don't say one word. Just sit back and learn. And I remember how I felt. So I give them a place and a voice, and we have some discussions, but I do give some guidance as well. So we have to play that role. And I'm not that, I'm 41, so I still kind of feel like I'm a little young. They let me know I'm not. But we're working together on a common goal.
Before we go, because you've been here, you've been so drunk with your time, you're obviously excited you're still here. Our struggle historically has been intergenerational.
Exactly.
To glorify your age, old or young, is not the point. If you look at this connection, when NAACP was outlawed in Alabama, Fred Shelsburg Negro formed the Alabama Christian Movement as a shoot-off of, but supporting with. They didn't dismiss the NWA as too old, but they had been outlawed. They related to them. Dr. King called upon the church base at 26. He didn't step outside of where the majority of our people were, and he founded SCLC in 1957. We sat down in 1960. SNCC formed in April at Shaw. Dr. King put up the first $5,000. SNCC joined the historic movement. They didn't try to start no new movement. They joined the nonviolent movement. They joined the protest movement. They joined the go to jail movement. They joined the freedom rights movement. They didn't just glorify age at the expense of wisdom and vision. Because in the end, it is not by age, it is by vision that you get to where you're going. If you have big numbers in the street and run past a voter registration, you're young, but you're off the point. If you have lots of Dr. King on a march on Washington, I don't know what it was in the movie, but if he had called the march, he felt that it had been, because of his prominence, it had been said no. He called upon A. Philip Randolph. It was always therefore, by Rustin. The struggle at its best is intergenerational. We must all build upon. That's why when I try to work between, say, Barbara and Tanya in the legal dimension, that's a whole world unto itself. A little different than the college world, a little different than the vote world, a little different than Joint Center. All this stuff kind of fits, and part of our job is for them to join in. They ain't starting something, they're joining something. Youth are not starting something, they're joining something. I went to jail as a student. Youth, I went to jail as the NAACP youth member. We went to jail, we were bailed out by some older lawyers. We didn't bail ourselves out of jail. we went to jail, but Attorney Sampson and Smith got us out of jail. And so there's a struggle forever to make things, say all things work to the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. I can figure out a bunch of reasons not to relate to Barbara and Tanya today.
Uh-oh.
But it's a mistake.
It would be a huge
mistake. I mean, of course, it's a huge one. And I'm saying if that is one spirit, one can achieve that, but to no good end. We must figure out how we can relate. What about us matters enough to fit.
And
be quiet, Barbara. No, I'm you did that to me. Be quiet, Barbara. No, I'm simply saying that a lot of the youth, for example, cannot get much further than the last person who got shot. But they got so much more to offer than that. The last Saturday, Barbara, a month ago, about 20 kids from Ferguson came up to our headquarters in Chicago. We began engaging in what can they do that can sustain. You can't sustain the Trayvon fire for so long. You can't sustain the Ferguson fire. So what do you do that will keep you moving and moving? And there are some things outside of you, your goal, which must kind of keeps you going. So if you're in Alabama, and they're about to close Alabama State and Alabama A&M. If you're in South Carolina and they're about to close South Carolina State, you got something to fight for. If you're in Louisiana and they're about to close Grambling, you got something to fight for. And it's not just, you get my point? If you're there and they're building for-profit jails and prison labor and closing, they're $120 million from the Department of Education, went to Alabama, and it was used for prisons, not for education. That's something to fight for. You mean $9 billion went to Alabama, was rejected because it was Medicaid? I mean, there ain't no shortage of low-hanging grapes out here. So we must at least use each other's energy and strength to bust this bubble. Yes, ma'am. Last, Michelle.
I was going to say it may be more of a perception problem because yes. In talking to some of the people that we've talked to, it's like, you know, oh, well, you know, Jesse Jackson and Martin Luther King, you know, we borrow some things from them, but we're doing a whole different thing. They're not necessarily understanding how young SNCC was and how much intergenerational work there was before. So my question was actually not so much a critique of them in a negative way. It's just how then does the old guard, so to speak, harness the power of the new so that these things are a little bit more visible.
Well, I'm following Barbara, and they can follow me.
I can tell you this.
Let us say.
I mean, honestly, we have been working, you know, as many people know, one of my other incarnations is that I head up the Civil Rights, you know, Ferguson and Policing Reform Coalition, which is a coalition of about 27 civil rights organizations and hundreds of individuals. And what we've been, but ever since October, I believe is correct, right? We have been talking directly with the heads of Hands Up and Black Lives Matter. And we are, in fact, we've been in contact since last night about, and they do seek advice, they do want guidance, they do want help. They are trying to learn from their elders. You know, they haven't, you know, I have not ran into the, you know, go get in the grave thing. You know, I haven't, you know, had any of that. You know, so I think that the issue is that we have to be open and understand that they are doing some new stuff that is quite different. And at the same time, they need to learn about a lot of things that's happened before them. So I'm not, you know, at all, you know, I understand it's complex and I understand, you know, that there's been conflicts and problems. Remember, I'm the person who got banned, you know, who got basically ostracized from the stage during the march. Right, run off the stage by the young folks because they were mad that they weren't given a place to speak. And I'm the one who had to keep listening to my name being called and not, you know, speaking for over an hour. But I don't hold it against them because, you know, we went back and we had to, you know, deal with all that stuff. And I think that that's the way you do real struggle. And we do the same kind of struggle with ourselves. You know, I mean, people my age, I'm having the same kind of struggles with. So I don't think it's, you know, I just think that we need to do the investment in them. Take the time, do the meetings, do the talks, you know, find out, you know, how we coalesce the best. And that's what we've been doing. I mean,
it's about time.
We do it weekly. And can I, I just want everybody to know before we end that I'm starting a new radio show. And I hope people will listen. Starting March 3rd, I'm going to be on WOL 1450 AM. Radio One, and it's going to be live broadcast all over the country on WOLDCnews.com. So I'm hoping that, you know, that also will be a platform. Thanks, everyone.
Let us stand together before we leave. Yes, sir. Let us stand together nonetheless. Yes, yes. The reason why we ask everybody to give that data stuff to you and to Frank and Barbara, of course, is we are going to reconvene. The day was to kind of begin open up this discussion in ways that had not been opened up before, Steve, that we might go to Selma commemorating and not celebrating. The celebration that we won, commemoration, we recognize the date, but we're under attack. And the attack we're under is a devastating attack. And it affects schools, jails, housing, life options, immigration. All that our coalition stands for is affected by Shelby. If I could just get us to think August 6, 1965, as a game changer. And June 25th, 2013, as a reversing of the motor. I just think the march, that we crossed this Edmund Pettus Bridge, we've not crossed the Shelby Bridge. And Shelby has all these dimensions all hooked up in it. And if young people begin to march in Shelby, we create a whole new dynamic. And our historical struggle always had continuity. Mandela and his partner, a lawyer, Tambo. They were young, but they joined the youth of ANC. They were young, but they joined a movement that was alive before they were alive. And that becomes the value of these struggles that is not, whether you coming in at 26 or 62, Moses started preaching at 80. The movement is not, you may be new, the movement is not, this movement to overcome the impediments ain't new. Just to know that's like getting humble. The ones must find humility in where you fit in a struggle that predates you and postdate you. And I would think that there may be many people marching for different reasons, March 7th and 8th. There's been more talk about 7th or 8th as the date than Shelby as the new challenge. Yeah, I'm going to speak down there and have another rally down there next week. We'll get back to you. I spoke down there last Sunday night. The people in Shelby last Sunday night did the church rally. They get a sense of Shelby. I learned things I just didn't know. I didn't know about Shelby as a suburb of Birmingham. Then there was a rich white Republican enclave that took on Selma, Dallas County, 40% unemployed and almost all black. I didn't get the dynamics just by reading. I had to get on the ground to appreciate really what Shelby is in contrast. One place, almost no unemployment. Another place, 40% unemployment. Another all-white rich Republicans. Another poor black farmers. I mean, you have to be on the ground to appreciate. What does this thing, who filed the suit? Who sustained the suit? But they took up a principle, and that principle was entitlement. And that principle was remove the troops, no different than remove the troops in 1870s. Once the troops left, tyranny came. Let us stand together.
Yes, slavery by another name. That's it.
Well, are you inviting people to march in Shelby instead of? Well, no, we can't just decide it right now. We can't do it that way. But we have to put it on the radar first. To think it, we have to first, once we have to think it through. And I'm here to tell you, once we go to Shelby and just walk around, look at the walls of Jericho, we got to think this thing through. I am very much the one to say we got to march in Shelby, but it's premature to announce it without talking to the family first. You can't just like be a horse disconnected from the wagon. I want to be connected. When we go in this, we need to take the wagon and the horse, because the wagon ain't connected to the horse, it's a show horse. But I'd rather be a working mule than a show horse. We got to connect ourselves to the wagon. So more for Tom Joyner got to understand Shelby Selman. He's from Alabama. You know, see must understand. Once our mouthpieces get this kind of content in, then Ricky Smiley. Once we get the content going, then people start thinking different. Right now, Shelby means nothing in the streets. Shelby means absolute. Selma, yes, movie. Selma, yes, lots of coverage. Shelby means zip. We got to change that. That's what our challenge is, I think. Should we join hands and bow our heads in prayer? Dear God, we thank you for this band of warriors who dare to think, who dare to gather, to be resolved for a bright morning of justice. For Ms. Boynton, Jose and John Lewis, and those who paid such huge prices, Dr. King and Ralph Abernathy and Shelsworth, for those who paid big dues. We thank you for them today, for they're at the height. For those who march these roads, be with them. We thank you for their contribution, for their spirit, even with us. And we thank you for Barbara and Tanya and those who dare to keep fighting in the best tradition of the legacy, to keep the hope alive. Then let them break our spirit, but give us the strength to turn to each other, not on each other, in a powerful way. But when we find a common thread, we'll make great things come our way and make heaven happy. Amen. Be sure everybody fill out that envelope now so we can stay in touch with each other, okay?
I was going to say, will you provide a participant list or something to us so we can continue to communicate?
We will.
I want to make sure you have
information.
Oh, yeah, we need your card.